Welcome everyone. It's a beautiful early February morning here in southern Ontario. I thought I'd finally go up for a flight again. Do a little bit of tests I've wanted to run on my autopilot for a while now. As most of you know, I had my instrument panel upgraded about 6 months or so ago. One of the things I decided not to upgrade was the autopilot at the time. I decided I would stick with my 45-ish year old Century 3 autopilot that came with the plane to begin with. And over the past few months, I've learned a few things about how it works with the all-new, all-digital Garmin gear that I had put in the panel. Some of the things were as expected. Some of the things I'm still trying to sort out exactly what's going on there. So join me as I go up and run a few of those tests.
Charlie Foxtrot Whiskey Tower, caution, there is a hawk circling over the main intersection. Traffic on the climb-out will be in the left-hand circuit, pass behind them. Left turnout, wind 230 at 3, clear takeoff, runway 12.
Left turnout, clear takeoff, runway 12, Charlie Foxtrot Whiskey.
Foxtrot Tower, this is Golf Alpha, Whiskey Delta, ready for takeoff, and the requesting takeoff on the road.
Alright, T's and P's are good, manifold pressure, RPM is good, airspeed's alive. There's that hawk. And rotate. Pause the rate gear up.
Papa Whiskey Delta Tower, caution, there is a hawk circling over the main intersection. Left turnout, clear takeoff runway 12.
Clear takeoff, call Papa Whiskey.
Back when I was planning my my panel upgrade, the avionics shop I was working with tried pretty hard to get me to upgrade my autopilot as well to put a Garmin GF500 in there. I thought long and hard about it. Unfortunately, the Garmin was the only option. It was either that or stick with my Century 3. For my plane, the Beechcraft Sierra, the Garmin is the only new autopilot that is certified for this plane. Bendix, King, and Trio have talked about possibly certifying their new autopilots for our plane, but who knows how long that'll take. So for now, it's either stick with the Century 3 or move up to the Garmin 500. And given the extra cost of putting the Garmin 500 and the fact that my Century 3 works okay, I decided to give it a shot and stick with the Century 3 and see what happens. The avionics shop kind of reluctantly agreed, but they pointed out several times they could not guarantee the functionality would be what I was expecting, because the interfaces between the new digital instruments and the old analog autopilot are, well, sketchy. Garmin says it'll work, but you can't guarantee it. So fast forward a couple of months, and I'd had the pilot plane back. I've been going up for some test flights, and everything with the autopilot seemed to be working okay, with a couple of exceptions that I'll talk through now. But before I do that, for those who are not familiar with the old Century autopilots, I'll do a quick walkthrough. If you want to skip ahead, there's chapter markers in the description. Skip ahead to the next chapter if you want to skip that. Keep in mind, I'm not an instructor, so please don't take this as any form of education. If you have gear kind of similar to mine, please refer to your pilot's guide manuals to figure out how they work. This is just meant to be an illustration of how my particular setup works in my plane. So my Century 3 is a two-axis system with the electric trim servo installed. So that means it rolls and it pitches, but it does not yaw. I need to control yaw with my rudder pedal myself. So there are two control heads for this autopilot. The main control head over here allows you to choose what you want the autopilot to actually do, what you want the plane to do. And then the radio coupler over here allows you to choose where you want the signals to come from. So let's start with the main control head. There are four modes you can set. First is roll mode. This is actually the master for the autopilot as well, so you either engage roll mode or the autopilot is off. I never use roll mode on its own. All it really does is allow you to set the roll heading or roll angle of the plane using this knob down here. I don't find all that useful. The next mode over is heading, and what that does is it takes the heading from the HSI over here and essentially tells the plane to follow that heading. So turn the plane left or right, roll the plane left or right in order to get to and then maintain that heading. The fourth mode over here is pitch mode. I'm going to come back to altitude for a second. So what this does is it allows you to tell it what pitch angle you want to set for the plane, up or down. And this wheel over here allows you to choose that pitch mode. See, right now, I'm in pitch mode right now, and I've set the wheel over here, and it is descending about 100 feet per minute. Pretty level right now, actually. And then the fourth mode is altitude hold mode. So once you're at the altitude you want to be and everything is stabilized, you can then engage that. And in theory, it should hold the altitude, the barometric altitude, based on the level that you push the button. So if I set it right now at 3480, and I engage it, it should maintain 3480. One of the issues I've been having lately is that it doesn't seem to be holding it. It seems to very slowly climb, and you can already see it starting to climb at about 100 feet per minute. So I'm going to disengage it. I'm going to talk more about the altitude hold issues that I've been having in a little. I'm going to start, though, by talking about the heading mode and how it works, both through the old panel and through the new panel. But before I do that, I just want to take a moment to say thank you for watching, and if you enjoy my videos or find them useful, I'd appreciate it if you'd hit that thumbs up button and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. It helps me figure out what you guys like to watch, and it also helps other people on YouTube find my videos a little bit more easily, so thank you. Well, let's talk about the heading mode and the radio coupler for a minute that I mentioned earlier. The coupler has five different modes: nav, omni, heading, localizer normal, and localizer reverse. I'll start with the omni heading, and essentially what it does is it tells the autopilot to get its heading information from the HSI or the directional gyro. There's a little bug on the left that you use to set the heading, and it takes that heading reading and uses that to direct the autopilot. The next one over is heading mode. I don't even know why they have that, because even in the manual that I have for the Century 3, all it says is that the heading mode does the same thing as the previous mode. Nav mode does something similar, but it smooths out the readings that are coming from the heading indicator from the directional gyro. In turbulent air, where you can be bouncing around a little bit, what that does is just smooths it out, doesn't make it react quite so quickly to minute little changes in heading. Now, with my new instrument, it does act a little bit differently, but I'll explain that later. The last two modes, localizer norm, localizer reverse, those are used for ILS and RNAV approaches, instrument approaches with a coupled glide slope, and they essentially allow the autopilot to capture the glide slope and fly the approach down to minimums, in theory. I'm having issues with that as well, which I will explain in a minute. So that's the basics of the Century 3. Keep in mind, it is a 45-year-old system. It is analog, and so the way it works with the new instruments, which are all digital, is a little bit different. Now, the GI-275s that I had installed can actually put out an analog signal to send to the autopilot that mimics the old analog signal coming from the HSI to tell it what direction, what heading to follow. Now, next to my GI-275 is a little switch that says GPS or heading. And so what that allows me to do is allow me to tell the GI-275 which heading to send to the radio coupler, which then sends it to the autopilot. So right now in heading mode, I have this little switch here, and if I rotate this little blue heading bug, it will tell the autopilot to roll the plane to head to that heading. So now if I switch that over to GPSS mode, as soon as I do that, instead of following the little blue heading bug, the GI-275 actually disables that bug and it tells it to follow the magenta line, which is now taking me direct towards Lindsay Municipal Airport. Now, the real difference between those two modes is that when you've got a flight plan programmed in, especially like an instrument approach when you're coming in for a landing, if I left the GI-275 in heading mode, I would actually have to turn the heading knob manually as I was getting to a turn to tell the plane where to turn. Whereas if I leave it in GPSS mode, the GI-275 will use the signal from the GTN 650, the flight plan, and automatically send the new headings to the radio coupler and onto the autopilot, so I don't have to turn the plane at all, even with the heading knob. It's a small thing, but anything that reduces pilot workload, especially in IMC, to me is a good thing. Now back to the radio coupler, you can see right now it's in heading mode. So even though this is in GPS mode, the radio coupler is in heading mode. If I switch it to nav mode, I actually find that it actually does a little bit of a better job tracking the magenta line, and it also does a better job of leading turns and getting me, or keeping me on the magenta line after a turn as well, whereas in heading mode it kind of tends to overshoot the turn a little bit and bring the plane back. Nav mode in combination with GPSS mode seems to be the best combination for me. So now with the vertical guidance, I mentioned a little bit earlier that I've been having an issue with it. So what I found was, generally when I put it into alt mode, it seemed like it was doing a really good job of holding the altitude plus or minus 100 feet, which is fine. But on a flight I did about a month ago, I kind of put it in altitude hold mode, and then 5 minutes later, I was tracking it, and I noticed that it had climbed almost 500 feet. Now, that was the day that it was perfectly VFR. I was flying VFR. I was just in the practice area. There were no other planes around, so it wasn't a big deal. But on an IFR flight plan, that would be a big deal. That's a little bit of an issue. So I wanted to go back up and do a couple of tests. So when I was up earlier this week with Neil, decided to test a little bit, seemed to be doing all right. And one of the things I wanted to test today was this ability to hold the altitude. So let's see what's happening. All right, gonna test out the altitude hold now. I'm at 3510, 3520, 3500. Let's see what happens over the next few minutes. Well, I keep an eye out for traffic, because there is a lot of flight training traffic up today. So it seems to have climbed almost 100 feet, but it's trying to level off. You can see here 3580. I set it when it was at 3500, 3510. Seems to be doing alright so far. Let's give it a few minutes, see what happens. And look at that, it's climbing up. It's almost at 3800. I don't like that. That is really not good. Kind of slowly and steadily climbing. So let's take off altitude hold mode and let's put it back into pitch mode.
Climb on area traffic, Cessna 150, Foxtrot Unit from Tango Sierra.
Get back to 3500. Now the localizer is kind of where I'm having an issue, a minor issue. The way it's supposed to work is that when you're on an approach and you're kind of on the final approach path and you're getting close to the glide slope from underneath, when you intercept that glide slope, it's supposed to capture that and then start your plane going down, tracking the glide slope all the way down to minimums. The autopilot's supposed to take care of all that for you. What I found during the tests that I did with the avionics guy after my panel upgrade was that it would kind of recognize the glide slope, but then instead of a gentle descent, it would actually kind of dive like a falcon going after a field mouse, which is, I don't know, maybe not the kind of approach that I want to fly. Now, before I had my panel upgraded, I never used the localizer mode to capture glide slopes anyway, so it's no loss of functionality for me, but it would be nice to have that working. The avionics shop was a little bit surprised as well when they saw that. That's one of the things where they said, you know, we can't guarantee that these old 45-year-old systems are going to work properly. I'm actually going to run a little bit of a test right now to see how it works. I've programmed in an approach into Lindsay Airport. I'm not going to do the full approach, but I will have the autopilot run the approach until the point where it intercepts the glide slope, and we'll see what happens. 1 minute to pick up. And it's going to be a sharp right turn.
Vertical track.
Really. Arriving at the waypoint, going to do a sharp right turn. One minute 20 seconds to a ready to tick up, and then at Udlis, and then I will switch over to localizer normal mode. Lindsay traffic, Gulf Charlie Foxtrot Whiskey, about 9 miles east of the field at 3,800 feet. Going to be overflying the field east to west at 3,500. Okay, we are turning on to final. We're in terminal mode. LNAV plus V mode. LNAV plus V mode, so I'm going to switch it over to localizer approach and put it in altitude hold mode. And we'll see what happens. Glide slope is coming in. Ready to deactivate autopilot. Alright, should have captured the glide slope. Not doing anything. No, not capturing it at all now. Well, that's better than it diving, but it's not what I want. Lindsay traffic, all clear, Fox Trot Whiskey, about 7 miles east of the field, breaking off, heading south towards Oshawa. Lindsay traffic. So, unfortunately, I mean, the tests worked, but the results are not what I ideally would want. Neither the glide slope. Glide slope doesn't work, which doesn't surprise me, I was expecting that. But altitude hold mode really seems to be having issues. Like right now, I am currently descending. I've descended almost 300 feet since I set the altitude hold mode on. At other times, it will climb several hundred feet or 200 feet over several minutes. So it's not looking too good right now. This interplay between the new GI-275s and the Century 3 autopilot seems to be a little flaky. So for now, I guess I fly without altitude hold mode, keep it in pitch mode, keep a closer eye on it. I don't know, maybe a year or two down the road I'll upgrade that autopilot. For now I'm going to head home to Oshawa. Thank you for watching everybody. If you enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button if you haven't already subscribed to my channel. Really appreciate it, means a lot to me. I'll see you in the next video, and in the meantime, fly safe.